I represent Infrastructure Development Corporation Karnataka, which is a joint venture between the Government of Karnataka, IDFC Foundation and HDFC Limited. The purpose of creating the company, which is today about 18 years old, was to specifically advise the governments, not just the Government of Karnataka, but across the country, and today we are advising governments outside of India as well, on developing projects in a manner that can be offered to the private sector, which essentially is PPPs, public-private partnerships. I think in that context, you know, the whole arena that is now open to startups is very interesting, because a lot of these ideas and innovations that are being produced and that are coming up from various entrepreneurs are also in the space of urban infrastructure and sustainability. So it's essential that we find a way to look at a standalone sustainable model as far as a partnership between the government and the private sector is concerned. So that's the role we play. And apart from that, of course, we have a small fund in Karnataka which we use for investments. So that's as far as IDIC is concerned. I head the business advisory team at IDIC that looks at urban infrastructure, renewable energy, and fund mobilization. As far as the session for today, I don't have slides. I thought this was a freewheeling discussion, so I'll keep it that way. I'd just like to highlight a couple of issues which in our experience with various governments, cities, we see completely missing as far as considering investors or financial institutions. And maybe a couple of examples. I frankly don't know if there are any city representatives here, which is more relevant for them, but I'll state it anyway if you are going to distribute this material. Now, as far as the issues that we see are concerned, so just to give you a background of these issues. Currently, Government of India is focusing on about 500 cities across the country, considering both smart city missions as well as what is called the Amrit missions, which is focused on sanitation and related activities. All these cities were advised to get themselves rated and to look at municipal bonds as an option to raise their funds, right? Now, out of the 500 cities, about 95 cities, I think, are rated. And out of these 95 cities, only 55 are in the investment grade. Okay, and we're talking about investment grade between AAA plus and BBB minus. Okay, so that's like six or eight levels between them. Now, there's not a single city out of these 55 that has got a rating of AAA plus. Okay, the best is AA plus. There are only about 25 cities out of these 55 that are in the band of AA to A. Okay, so we're talking about a mere 5% that's good to go with municipal bonds with attractive interest rates, notwithstanding the external conditions of changes in interest rates. So that's the current situation. So what's the problem that we are facing with governments and cities as far as raising finances is concerned? their ability to borrow, right? Their ability to guarantee payments, which is practically non-existent. Okay, so not referring to the 5% of the cities. And incidentally, a quick fact check on this, between the cities that are rated, the 25 cities that have gone for municipal bonds, the difference in interest rates on their coupons is from 7.5% to 8.9%. Okay, and we're talking about the ones that fall in the band of A, AAA plus to AAA, A minus. So this is really an issue. And why is this an issue? And now with the SEBI guidelines of who can actually raise municipal bonds, the requirement is for the cities to have their finances in order, right? To be able to be responsible with their finances, to ensure that their revenue streams are good enough to sustain such guarantees. And we are referring to the lowest possible interest rate that they can actually raise. If they were to go commercial financing, obviously these rates would be much higher. So clearly there is an issue with the financial situations at the city levels, and which is why we also don't see that many PPP projects at cities on the basis of guarantees provided by cities, right? We've seen large waste to energy projects offered by larger cities. I wouldn't name them because they are our clients, who weren't able to attract investors in spite of showing cash guarantees, right? Because the risk of future payments is still in question. Okay, so that's one. The second is because the government is inviting the private sector to invest in projects in the core infrastructure that we're talking about. The general thought process is that there's a whole lineup of investors waiting to invest in your project, and that the investors are falling over each other to acquire this project. That isn't the case at all. If there is no good project, and when we say a good project, a project that is structured well, commercially, contractually, financially, if that isn't available, investors aren't there. We see a lot of our clients continue to have this thought process, and it is, as advisors, our responsibility also to show them the real picture, which we try and do in as many cases as we can. That said, I'd like to highlight two examples, and I would imagine this is a lot more helpful to the cities if they're participating here, of how innovative financing structures were used to finance public infrastructure. So the first is a project that was done in the late 90s, early 2000s, when PPP as a concept itself was new to India. We saw one of the first innovative financing structures in this space, where the city of Alandur in Tamil Nadu was able to use a combination of commercial financing, grants, and public financing to finance a sanitation project, which meant creating a covered sewage network and having a sewage treatment plant for that city. It's not even a city, it's a town. It had about 20,000 households at that point of time. Okay, so the commitment of the council was to the extent that for the commercial debt that they borrowed, they have guaranteed or rather escrowed their entire tax revenue. Okay, you don't see this in cities usually, okay, to be willing to guarantee your tax revenue, which is bulk of your revenue, towards repayment of this debt. But that's not the unique thing. The unique thing that they did was about 25% of the project cost was raised by taking contributions from the public as one-time fees. Okay, that's in percentage terms, it's significant. In absolute terms, it's not that high because the project cost really wasn't that large in today's time. But 25% of the funds were collected from the public as one-time fees. Now, this was a result of continued interaction between the then mayor of the council and the officers with the public. So for a small town of 20,000 households, you don't, I mean, it's practically difficult. I mean, today, BWSSB in Bangalore is trying to get their upfront fee of 2,000 or 3,000 rupees per household for water supply connections, and they are struggling to achieve 100%, right? For Alandu, each household has paid over 2,500 rupees, I think. I'll have to check the correct figure, but the point was they were able to do that by showcasing the future benefits to the people there. The benefits of having a covered sewage network, the benefits of having a sewage treatment plant, right? So this is one. The second example is more recent. If any of you have read the Times of India today, on the fourth or the fifth page, there's an article about Infosys Foundation paying to build a metro station, right? And I'm very happy to say that we are involved with the Bangalore Metro in in this process of their innovative financing, where before the first tender that they issued for construction of that reach, which is called 2A, if I'm not wrong, as part of phase two of the metro network, they have received commitments of 500 crores out of a project cost of 4,200.
This is for the visit, if you
to finance their project.
You want to put a name if you want to go.
And this is by leveraging options like naming rights, direct connectivity to campuses, and that's a very dense community there, the entire outer ring road. I don't know if Athar is located there, but that road from Marathali all the way to Silk Road Junction, it's crowded with large IT companies. They've leveraged that to offer naming rights to potential companies there and raised 500 crores. And this is not adding the 200 crores that Infosys has committed today. Not today, I think the MOU was signed a week ago. But these are the kind of innovations you would expect cities to come up with the kind of assets they have at city level, with the kind of leverage they can take it with all the assets they have, the land holding, TDRs are, I don't know how many cities are really utilizing the TDR benefits to finance their urban projects. So this brings me to the end of some of the thoughts I wanted to share on what are the options for cities to raise finances to build their own infrastructure.